continue to be our prayer day by day, that we want to be, because the heart of that prayer has to do with our being in right relationship with God, our being fully owned by God, fully filled by God. Today we're going to continue to look at the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5. So as you find that, I invite you to stand. Matthew chapter 5, we're going to begin looking at verse 13 today. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 to 20. I invite you to hear the gospel of the Lord today. Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them, teaches them, will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." And this is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to Christ. Father, we thank you for your word today. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your Sermon on the Mount. And may your Holy Spirit so fill us in the hearing of these words and also in this time of preaching that we might be shaped to glorify you. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. You may be seated. Upon reading a passage from the gospel, it is traditionally announced and declared, and you've heard me say this, but if you can go to some other churches, you might hear it there as well, but it is declared the gospel of the Lord, and the church traditionally responds enthusiastically, "Praise to you, Lord Christ." But I have to say, upon looking at this passage, it's a little difficult to get all that excited, isn't it? I mean, really, what do we see in this passage? First, we read that we are the salt of the earth. But be careful, because if the salt has lost its saltiness, it's no longer good for anything, but it's thrown out and it's trampled underfoot. That doesn't sound too good, does it? So we better stay salty, because if we don't, we are in big trouble. And so that immediately causes us to question, how salty am I? Have I already lost my flavor? Have I already been thrown out good for nothing? And so we had better get busy being salty, whatever that means. And then we read that we are the light of the world. And so we better be shining our light for others to see. And the way that we do that is by being sure to do a lot of good works. So how have we been doing our good works? How have we been doing shining for others to see? In other words, we better get busy working hard so that others can see. And if that weren't enough, Jesus drives it home by making clear that he did not come to abolish the law and the prophets. So much for talk about being under grace and not under law. So much for this talk about being saved by grace and not by works. Jesus says, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass away from the law until all is accomplished. The King James Version says, and some of you will be familiar with this whenever I say it, but not one jot or one tittle will pass away. How many of you remember that? Not one jot, not one tittle will pass away. I'm not sure what a jot and a tittle are. But it seemed to me that reminded me of something in Greek. And so I got out my Greek New Testament, and lo and behold, I was right. It says, not one iota, And some of you may be familiar with that term. Not one iota. Anybody familiar with that term? Yeah. Does anybody know what an iota is? Well, an iota is a Greek letter. Whenever you transliterate it into English, it's an I. And in this case, it's a small lowercase I. In Greek, it's just this little hook. That's all it is. Just a little hook there. And more than that, behind that is the Hebrew yod, which is even smaller. And then the tittle is really just a kind of ornamental mark that's made on a Hebrew letter. That's all it is. And Jesus says, not one of these little tiny marks will pass away from the wall until all is accomplished. Further, if we break even the least of the commandments, we are in big trouble. And just in case we haven't gotten it yet, Jesus declares, I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter into the kingdom of heaven. And the scribes and the Pharisees were all about righteousness. They live and breathe the law. But we had better not just be as righteous as them, but we had better be more righteous than them, or we aren't going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. The gospel of the Lord. Anybody ready to say praise to you, Lord Christ? The gospel reading for today, and aren't you glad that you came? I know that some of you probably wish that you stayed in bed and turned on the TV so that you could hear how God wanted to make you happy and successful and wealthy today. But instead, you got up and you came, and that's the gospel reading for us. And yet, is it possible that this really could be good news today? Is it possible that the way that I've just described this passage and the way that we oftentimes read it, or we sometimes prefer to skip over it, is really a misreading of the passage? Let's take a closer look. What we see and what we discover, first of all, is that Jesus came not to abolish the law and the prophets. After all, when we read an Old Testament passage, it's the tradition of the reader, and you hear me read it, I will say afterwards, not the old law that's been done away with, that's not important anymore. And everybody says, thanks be to God. Now, that's not what I read. What I say after I read an Old Testament passage is, the word of the Lord. Just like I say whenever I read an epistle passage, the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The law and the prophets refers to the law, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Old Testament. And then the prophetic writings, the prophets that are there. And they form the very heart of the Old Testament. And so the law and the prophets, along with the historical writings and the Psalms and the wisdom literature, came to us from God. They are God-inspired. As St. Paul says about the law, it's not evil, but it is good. It too points us to who God is and what God is like. And if we are to be restored in the image of God, it paints a picture of what we are called to be as well. So Jesus did not come to abolish the law and the prophets. Rather, he came to fulfill them. You see, as good and as inspired as they are, they are not in and of themselves the fullness. They point ahead. They reflect for us who God is and what God is like, but they point ahead to the one who will perfectly display for us the very nature of God. They point ahead to the one who is the very image of the invisible God. They point ahead to the Messiah, to Christ Jesus. And I've said this many times before, but the Old Testament always points us ahead to Jesus. The epistle readings, the letters, they always point us back to Jesus. And when we read the gospel, we see Jesus right there. Jesus did not come to abolish the law and the prophets. He came to fulfill them. Every jot and tittle of them. They pointed ahead to him, and he is the one who shows us the divine image of God himself. And therefore, Jesus, who is the very image of the invisible God and the fulfillment of the law and the prophets, he is the one who has the authority to interpret the law and the prophets truly. Do you want to see what the law and the prophets are all about? what they're really all about, look at Jesus. Look at Jesus. He fulfills them. Secondly, when Jesus says that unless our righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, we will never enter into the kingdom of heaven, he's really, when he says that, he's getting to the heart of the matter. Oh, indeed, as I've said, the scribes and the Pharisees, they were all about righteousness. They would have agreed that every jot and tittle of the law is going to remain. That is what they are about, following every letter of the law. It's just that they so often miss the spirit of the law, the true meaning, the intent of the law, the heart of the matter. Like the good works that Jesus calls us to when he refers to us as the light of the world. The Pharisees, they did good works all the time. But Jesus said that they did them in order to be seen by others, in order to be praised by others. The law said to do it, and they did it, so that others would praise them. In the verses that follow our text, still in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says this: "You have heard it said, you shall not murder. Letter of the law. But I say to you that if you are angry with your brother and sister," getting to the heart of the matter, "you have heard it said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her," where? In his heart. And he goes on in the Sermon on the Mount. You see, in order for our righteousness to exceed that of the scribes and the Pharisees, something has to change in our hearts. We have to have a heart that is transformed through faith in Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. We have to have a fulfillment of the words of the prophet that says that God is going to write these laws upon our hearts, so that it is not just about following the letter of the law, but it is about the one who fulfills the law living on the inside of us and living through us. You see, when the law is fulfilled, it is no longer seen as a legalism or a checklist. That's the problem with checklists. It's not that they're bad. It is not that having the do's and don'ts is a bad thing in and of itself. But having the list of do's and don'ts in and of themselves doesn't change the heart. But Jesus, who came not to abolish the law and the prophets, but to fulfill them, Jesus, who is the fulfillment of the law and the prophets, so transforms us by the power of the Holy Spirit that the law is no longer just this list of do's and don'ts, but now it has become a part of who we really are by faith, by the power of the Holy Spirit. As we say, we have died with Christ in baptism, and we have been raised to him in newness of life. And Christ continually shapes us in this as we receive him at the table. We partake of Christ, who fulfills the law and the prophets. We internalize him by his grace. And so Jesus says to us, not simply work hard at being salted, and not simply, you better go out there and try really hard to shine your light. What is it that he says to us? He says, you are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. As we are baptized into Christ Jesus, something has happened to us. As we place our faith in him by the working of the Holy Spirit, there has been a change that takes place. I want to illustrate this. Just thinking about this. When I remember the guy I talked about in the other church that I baptized, 83 years old and everything. The next Sunday that he came in, he said to me this: "You know, since I've been baptized, I just feel like a whole new man." Yeah. See, God is at work. He is changing us by the grace of God. We, it is plural, you, whenever he said, you are the light of the world. It's a plural. So we are the salt of the earth. By God's grace, we are the light of the world. And indeed, Christ calls us to live out who we are, doesn't he? You are the salt of the earth. So live it out. Be what you are. Be salt. Flavor. Preserve. Be salt in the world. Because, if salt loses its saltiness, it's no longer being salt, is it? It's not good for anything then, is it? So be who you are in Christ and see the difference that He makes in the world through us. Quick example. We heard it in a testimony that Vicki gave. And so I'm going to pick on her again. But you remember, if you were here, the testimony of be at peace with all people and the kind of little argument thing that happened there. And the call of God while she was there to go and apologize. Let me tell you, that's salt, that's light. That is seasoning the relationship. That is shining forth the light of God in our world. And here's the thing. I'm going to keep going with this. Here's the thing with that. Yes, there was the scripture, be at peace with all people. But this was not simply a scripture of list of do's and don'ts. Oh yeah, okay, here's my list, be at peace, okay, check mark and go off. No, it was the God who transforms her, who lives within us, speaking to her, saying, remember, be at peace. Yeah, this is who I am. This is who you are. This is who you are. And salt takes place. Light takes place. You are the light of the world. Don't hide from that. Shine. Folks, shine. Now you know Jesus is called the light of the world. We are the light of the world, not because of our own light, but because He is the one who is shining in and through us. So let's be the light. That city that is built on a hill that can't be hidden. Right? And I mentioned this because we just came through the inauguration, despite what you may have heard during all that time. Whenever Jesus says that, He's not talking about our nation or any other nation. He's talking about the church. He's talking about us. You're the city that's built on a hill. You can't be hidden. You're a light. Don't hide it under a bushel someplace. Just be who you are in the world and shine forth, because the light that you are shining forth is the light of Jesus. Yes, we are to be about good works, because by the grace of God, that's who we are on the inside. That is the transformation that God's grace has accomplished in our hearts. And we can't help keep that hidden in our hearts, can we? It has to find a way out. See, the light of Jesus has to find a way out. The saltiness of Jesus has to find a way out. The compassion of Jesus has to find a way out. By the grace of God, we are the light of the world. So by the empowerment of the Holy Spirit dwelling within us, let us shine. Not so that people will give to us applause and praise and glory like the Pharisees, but so that others will see our good works and give glory to our Father who is in heaven. Amen? This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.